Lecture 9. The No-Self Theory and Time Worms.
We have been pondering the question of personal identity over time. We have considered, as answers to this question, the soul hypothesis, psychological continuity, physical continuity, and Nozick's closest continuer view. But they have all fallen short in one way or another. Some philosophers suggest that the failure of these theories actually reveals something of major philosophic importance. Perhaps the reason we are unable to answer the question is because it was a bad question to begin with. And one reason it might be a bad question is because it is an empty question. Now, what is an empty question? Consider once again the ship of Theseus. Recall, the passengers replaced every board on the ship as it rotted away with new boards. And by the time they arrived at their point of destination, the ship was made entirely of new material. We asked whether it was still the same ship, Theseus's ship. Most people would agree that it is. Now, if the ship had rotted away all at once, and they had built a new ship out of new wood, obviously that wouldn't be the same ship. But the ship underwent gradual change, one board at a time, and so we think it's the same ship. But what if they had replaced two boards at a time? Or four? Or a quarter of the ship all at once? Or maybe half or three quarters? How much change at one time is too much? Or what if you found out that another ship was following behind and collecting the rotted pieces of wood that were being thrown overboard? And then that old wood was reassembled in just the way it had originally been assembled. Now which one is Theseus's ship? This might seem to change your answer, even though there is nothing different about the ship on which the original passengers arrived. After going round and round on the issue for a while, you start to realize that it's probably a bad question to begin with. It's not like there's the wooden planks arranged in a certain kind of way, and then there's this other thing called Theseus's ship that somehow sits on or is attached to those pieces of wood. It's like we're wondering whether such a thing did or did not stay attached to the original wooden planks. There's just the original wood, the wood from the barrels, and how they are configured in different situations. And we can choose to describe that situation in one way or the other. It's still Theseus's ship, it's not Theseus's ship. But it's not like one way gets it right and some other way doesn't get it right. Once we describe what happened, there's nothing else to say. It's kind of like the pile heap problem that we talked about last lecture. You have a small pile of sand and you add one grain at a time. When does the pile become a heap? There's no right answer to this question. There's just a collection of sand that keeps getting bigger and bigger, and you can call it a heap when you want, but you'll never be right or wrong for doing so. There is no separately existing thing called a heap that magically gets added onto the pile once it reaches a certain size. It's all just convention, the way we choose to describe things. It is, we might say, a linguistic problem, not a metaphysical problem. Some philosophers, especially the American pragmatists like Charles Sanders Peirce and William James, thought most philosophical problems could be solved in this way, by a clear definition and disambiguation of terms. My favorite example is this. Suppose a squirrel is climbing a tree, circumnavigating its trunk. Suppose you are also circumnavigating the trunk of the tree at the same pace as the squirrel and in the same direction. So, as you circumnavigate the tree, the squirrel's back is always facing you, but you go all the way around the tree. Question: did you go around the squirrel? Think about it for a second. Now, if you answered, "It depends on what you mean by the word around," then you're correct. If by around you mean that you were to the north and then the east and then the south and then the west of the squirrel, then yes, you went around the squirrel. If by around you mean you were facing its back, its left, its front, and then its right, then no, you didn't go around the squirrel. And there is no right or wrong definition of the word around. There is no metaphysical fact about what the word means. It can mean different things, and depending on what the person asking the question meant, you would have to answer it in different ways. In fact, such considerations have given rise to an entire ontology, a philosophy of existence. What we can truthfully say exists in the world is a metaphysical question, and many philosophers give a very simple answer to it. All that exists is the universe, the material that makes it up, and that's it. We just divide that material up in different ways. Now, this might initially seem strange to you. Doesn't my TV exist? Doesn't my house exist? But when you think about it, this is just like the Ship of Theseus example. There is no extra thing called your house above and beyond the material that makes it up. There's just material, and we describe it in a certain way. So, let's say there are X number of things in the universe, and you have a piece of paper. You then tear that piece of paper in half. Are there now X plus 1 things in the universe? Have you added a new thing, another piece of paper? No, all you have done is arrange the matter of the universe in a different way than it was before. But nothing new has been added. In fact, all the matter that makes up all the objects in the universe has existed since the beginning of the universe. When we make a new object, all we're doing is arranging pre-existing matter into a new configuration. And when we destroy it, we're just arranging it in yet another way. We are not adding or subtracting anything to or from the universe. All that exists is the universe, and the parts of it can be arranged and described in different ways. In philosophy of mind, some say that the same thing is true of persons. Persons don't exist. It's not that there's not a collection of matter sitting wherever you are sitting listening to this lecture. There is. It's just that, just like the Ship of Theseus, there is not some extra separately existing discrete thing called a person that exists in addition to that collection of matter. And that collection of matter is not a person itself. That collection of matter can be described in different ways in different scenarios, like in a transporter scenario or a brain-switching thought experiment, but it's all just description. It's all just convention. Since persons don't exist, there is no right or wrong answer, no right or wrong way to describe the situation. Now, you might think this no person or no self view is a crazy view, but we have actually already seen a phenomenon that suggests it's true. Let me borrow and modify an argument from the philosopher Thomas Nagel. Think back to the first lecture when we talked about split brain patients. The right hemisphere often acts on its own in the everyday world, and under experimental conditions, it has its own unique experiences. Roger Sperry, in his original experiments, concluded that by itself, the less dominant right hemisphere has basic reading and logical reasoning skills, including math skills. It can comprehend verbal language and draw spatial relations, and it also has emotional reactions and can even express disapproval, especially disapproval of the left hemisphere. A split-brain patient can even accomplish 2 tasks, one with each hand, as efficiently as 2 separate persons can accomplish such tasks. A disconnected right hemisphere, it seems, at least under experimental conditions, has a mentality equivalent to at least a 5-year-old child. But a 5-year-old child is a person. So, during experimental conditions at least, it seems that we would have to say that there are 2 persons in one body in a split-brain patient. One might be tempted to say that there is one person with 2 mutually inaccessible minds, but that doesn't really make sense. A person is a subject of consciousness. Thus, a person must have access to all the mentality they possess. One person can't have 2 minds. But if there is a second person in split-brain patients during experimental conditions, where was that person before the experiment? And where did they go after? Do they just pop into existence when you're feeding information to only one hemisphere, and then pop out of existence when you're done? That doesn't make sense either. The other person must be there all along, even outside the experiment. But if the concept of person applies to anything, it applies to an unsplit human brain, right? So that means the cutting of the corpus callosum actually creates a separate person. But that seems odd for a couple of reasons. First of all, that means that if I repair the corpus callosum of a split-brain patient, I am actually killing a person, making a person cease to exist. In addition, I could make someone pop in and out of existence by repeatedly cutting and then repairing someone's corpus callosum. It seems strange for such an action to have such metaphysical powers. But stranger still, it's unclear why cutting the corpus callosum would create a new person, a new stream of consciousness. Clearly, as Sperry's experiment shows us, the right hemisphere is capable of producing a stream of consciousness on its own. But all the corpus callosum does is send information from one hemisphere to the other. Why would the right hemisphere's ability to send and receive information to and from the left hemisphere hinder its ability to produce a stream of consciousness. Wouldn't the corpus callosum merely enable it to convey information about its conscious experiences to the other hemisphere? Thus, it seems that the phenomena of split brains forces us to conclude that there are two persons in even non-split brains, one for each stream of consciousness emerging from each hemisphere. But again, if the concept of a person, a single person, applies to anything, it applies to unsplit brains, right? But, as we just learned, it can't. And so it would seem the concept of a person must actually apply to nothing. In short, we might say that neither 1, 2, nor any other number can be the correct answer to the question exactly how many persons are present in the case of a split-brain patient. And so, the concept of person must not apply to anything. The truth is, philosophers and religious icons have been telling us this for centuries. The philosopher David Hume, for example, said that all that really exists are bundles of perceptions, collections of experiences, and there is no extra thing called the person that exists above and beyond that. All disputes about personal identity really are just verbal disputes, which can be solved simply by clarifying your definitions, like the word around in the squirrel and tree example. And thousands of years earlier, the Buddha told us essentially the same thing, suggesting that the terms self and I do not really refer to anything. They are just grammatical devices. Philosophers that argue for the no-self theory, like James Giles, are quick to point out that the words I, you, self, and person are not meaningless or useless. This separates such philosophers from the eliminative materialists who thought that language about mind should be eliminated. Giles thinks that referring to persons is perfectly meaningful, and the word self is more than just a sound. It's just that there are two different kinds of speech, conventional speech and ultimate speech. The proposition, there is a self, can be conventionally true, but it is not ultimately true. As Giles says, it is a properly understood term whose proper use is determined by mutual agreement. And although personal names and personal pronouns do not at the ultimate level refer to anything, at the conventional level, it is quite acceptable to use such expression for pragmatic reasons. But he does warn us that we must not be led astray by using such words into thinking that they refer to anything that is ultimately real. Some might think that Descartes proved the existence of selves with his famous argument, "I think, therefore I am." But many argue that all that follows from his premise is that thinking exists. And there is thinking, therefore there are thoughts, does not demonstrate the existence of a separately existing person. One might argue that his argument does work because thinking is a verb, and so it requires a subject, something to do the thinking. But the fact that it's true that some verb is being performed does not entail that it must be being performed by some existing entity. The it in it thinks may refer to nothing more than the it in its thundering. It's just a grammatical convention. The no-self theory makes great sense of why all our other theories have failed to answer our question about the survival of persons over time. It was a bad question to begin with, because persons, at least as they are traditionally conceived as single subjects of consciousness, don't exist. But, despite the philosophical sense it makes, it still is a hard philosophical pill to swallow. But never fear, we have one last theory to consider that also accounts for why our previous theories may have failed, why the question of personal identity is a bad question, and it doesn't deny the existence of persons. This theory was developed by David Lewis, and I call it the time worm theory. It suggests that our questions about personal identity are bad, not because persons don't exist, but because we've been conceiving of persons in the wrong way. To see Lewis's point, imagine your favorite TV show. One of mine is Doctor Who. Doctor Who is a British science fiction show that first aired in 1963 about a time traveler called the Doctor from the planet Gallifrey. The first episode was called An Unearthly Child. Doctor Who lasted until 1989, when it was canceled. There was a made-for-TV Doctor Who movie in 1996, and then the series was reimagined and re-released in 2005. In November of 2013, the 50th anniversary special was aired. The show has been able to last so long and still stay fresh for a couple of reasons. One, the Doctor can go anywhere in time and space in his time machine called the TARDIS. So in one episode, he can be in the Wild West, in another, he can be in prehistoric times, in another, he can be in a planet far away and in the future. He can be at the beginning of the universe and at the end. The possibilities are almost endless, and so each episode is unique. It's also able to stay fresh because there is a lot of cast turnover. The Doctor always travels with companions, but they change every year or two, and some only last an episode. Even the Doctor changes. He is an alien, and his race can avoid death by regenerating. So every now and again, he'll get injured, regenerate, and poof, he looks different and is played by a different actor, and the show goes on. At least 12 different actors have played the Doctor. When the show originally started in 1963, it was in black and white. The budget was low, the special effects were terrible, the stories were almost intolerably long, and the Doctor was a crotchety old man played by William Hartnell traveling with his granddaughter. The 50th anniversary special, on the other hand, was shot in high definition. You could even see it in 3D in some British theaters. It had a large budget, great special effects, the story was well written and exciting, and the Doctor at the time, at least one of them, was played by a 30-year-old heartthrob named Matt Smith, traveling with an equally attractive brunette companion. Now, with all that in mind, here's the question I want you to consider. Is the first episode the same television show as the 50th anniversary special? Think about it for a moment. Notice, I didn't ask you to answer it, but consider it. Does the question really make sense? Not really. Neither the first episode nor the 50th anniversary special is a television show. They are episodes of a television show. Television shows aren't aired in their entirety in one night. They exist stretched across time. Television shows are collections of episodes. What I think we mean to be asking is whether An Unearthly Child and the 50th anniversary special are episodes of the same show. Do they belong to the same series? They're obviously not the same episode, but are they members of the same set? To get an answer to this question, we could consider similarities and differences between the two episodes, talk about whether the new episodes harken back to the old ones, they do, by the way, talk about a causal thread that runs through the series, etc. I won't argue about that here. But when David Lewis suggests that our question about personal identity is a bad question, he thinks it's because we should have been conceiving of persons like television shows, not as three-dimensional objects that exist at particular moments in time, but as four-dimensional objects stretched over a long period of time. So asking whether you now and your 8-year-old self are the same person is like asking if two episodes of a show are the same show. Your 8-year-old self is not you, it's just an episode of you. You now is not you, it's just an episode of you. Lewis calls your episodes time slices. And a person, Lewis says, just is a collection of time slices spread out over time. A time worm. And so what we should be asking is, in virtue of what do you now and your 8-year-old self belong to the same time worm? And we could answer this question in ways that we've already suggested. For example, by referring to a psychological or physical continuity that exists through the worm which you now and your 8-year-old self have in common. The nice thing about Lewis's theory is that it can answer almost all of the thought experiment counterexamples that we have considered. When Spock transports down to the planet, his personal identity is preserved. Or, more precisely, the person slice that appears on the planet belongs to the same time worm as the person slice who stepped into the transporter. And the same thing is true even if, when Spock beams back up, the matter of his original body is lost and the Enterprise transporter has to create a new body for him. It can even handle the Riker splitting example. To understand how, think of when you were driving on an interstate and found that you were actually on two roads at once. When I was in grad school at the University of Oklahoma, there was a small stretch of I-35 that overlapped with I-40 in the middle of Oklahoma City. You could be driving along on I-40 and then all of a sudden discover that you were also on I-35. Now, neither I-35 nor I-40 existed fully in that location. Interstates are kind of like asphalt worms spread out over the country. Like television shows, they are not identical to any particular slice that is a part of them. But two interstates can cover the same stretch of road, like I-35 and I-40. But that does not make them the same road. This is what happened to Riker after the transporter accident. If you were to look at the whole timeline, you would see two time worms, two collections of person episodes. It would just be that those two time worms shared certain episodes. Certain episodes belong to both. In Riker's case, they share all the episodes before the transporter accident. If you were to draw it out, it would look like a line that has been split in two, kind of like a sideways Y. The time worm theory can even handle really weird examples that we haven't considered yet. For example, on an episode of Star Trek Voyager, the transporter combined two persons into one and then split them apart again. David Lewis can describe the situation quite easily with three time worms, one for the combined person and two for the individual persons, both of which overlap with all the episodes of the combined person. Draw that one out and it kind of looks like an X. So persons are time worms, and time worms are sets of person time slices. But we have to be a little more precise, because anything can be a set. When dealing with set theory, you could take a pencil, a Rubik's Cube, and a Blu-ray of Inception and call them a set. But that shouldn't mean that they make up an object. In the same way, I could group together any person time slices I wanted. Take some from me, some from you, some from a stranger, and then call them a set. But that wouldn't make a time worm. That wouldn't really be a person. We need some kind of criteria that determines what can belong to a particular time worm that would be considered a person and what can't. Our initial thought is to turn to physical or psychological continuity and say that any set of time slices that are sufficiently continuous would belong to a time worm. That would seem to keep strangers out, and that's a pretty good start, but it can't be the whole story. Your time slices from today are sufficiently continuous, but they don't make up an entire time worm. Usually people exist for longer than a day. What Lewis suggests is that a time worm that can be identified as a person is a set of person slices that is sufficiently continuous and that is maximally large. In other words, one that includes all the sufficiently continuous slices there are. So we couldn't only include your time slices from today, since there are other sufficiently continuous slices that we could include to make the set larger. But this is where Lewis runs into a bit of a problem. Consider an Alzheimer's patient who goes completely senile in his last 5 years. He can't remember who he is, his family members, his past experiences. He's completely lost. What would constitute his time worm? We could include every time slice from his physical birth to his physical death, but that would include his last 5 years. His psychological continuity was so broken in those years that the psychological continuity of the entire set would be quite low. Let's say 50%. If we don't include those last 5 years in his time worm, you wouldn't have the largest set possible, but it would be 100% psychologically continuous. So, what's more important? Maximal size or psychological continuity? When should we say this person died? When their body physically died, or when their mind ceased to exist? Now, as a physicalist, Lewis himself would likely prefer the maximal set. So he would say it was when their body physically died. Lewis's theory itself, however, gives us no way to answer this question, so at best his theory is incomplete. Lewis would also have a tough time accounting for how we should describe what I call spin-off persons. In television, a spin-off is a show that branches off from another show. Frasier was a spin-off of Cheers. The Simpsons was a spin-off of The Tracey Ullman Show. Torchwood is a spin-off of Doctor Who. It's even an anagram of the words Doctor Who. How should we divide up these television shows? Clearly there are two sets, but do the episodes of the spin-off belong to the original series? Or are they two entirely separate entities with no overlap at all? I'm not sure how to answer these questions, and it's one that we may have to worry about with persons in the near future. Suppose one day you were cloned. Clearly this creates a new time worm, but does that time worm share your original time slices from before you were cloned? Or suppose you were duplicated, creating a physically separate but psychologically continuous person. Would that person share your previous time slices? Again, although Lewis himself might prefer one answer over another, Lewis's theory itself gives us no way to answer these questions, and so seems inadequate. But Lewis's theory also has a couple of other unintuitive consequences. For example, how many persons are in your house right now? Regardless of how many bodies there actually are, if Lewis is right, everyone should answer this question in every circumstance with the same answer: zero. Persons do not exist at any particular location at any particular point in time. Person slices do. Persons are four-dimensional objects stretched out over time. They cannot be in a house at a particular time. So the answer to how many people there are in a particular location will always be zero. Lewis would probably argue that this is no more unintuitive than the realization that you can't watch an entire television show by staring at your screen for 1 second. Persons, like shows, simply don't exist in that way. But Lewis's theory also has this strange consequence. It seems to entail that persons don't exist until they die. If persons are time worms, maximally large continuous sets of person slices, they don't exist until the set is complete, until it is fully maximal. But your time worm will not be complete until you die. So you don't exist until you die? Or worse yet, you may never exist. Some philosophers think that all that truly exists is the present moment. The past did exist, and the future will exist, but neither currently exists. So, it's never the case that anyone's time worm actually fully exists in its entirety. And so, at least on this view of time, persons never exist. But this brings up another very interesting metaphysical question. What exactly is the nature of time? Is the present all that ever exists? Or does the past still exist in some way? Does the future exist before it occurs? If it does, Lewis could avoid saying strange things like, you don't exist until you die. But the metaphysics of time is an extremely complicated issue. But here's the good news, it's the topic of our next lecture. But before we get to it, let's review. We've been considering a metaphysical question very relevant to the nature of reality, and specifically the nature of persons, the question of personal identity. How is it that you are the same person over time? We discovered that the soul hypothesis does not give us a very satisfactory answer. Not only is it subject to the same objections we considered before when talking about the nature of minds, but even if souls exist, they cannot help us answer the question of personal identity because they cannot be delineated. Relying on memory or psychological continuity didn't work either. Not only are they not always necessary for survival, but they also allow for duplication, something that personal identity cannot tolerate. We looked at physical continuity as well, and that theory came across similar objections. Even combining the two theories and thinking that both physical and psychological continuity is required led to the problem of vagueness. You would have to draw an arbitrary cutoff point where any minor additional change would cause someone to cease to exist. Nozick's closest continuer view was a little better and could account for many of the counterexamples, but led to the strange consequence of it being possible for someone's survival to be dependent upon their death. If you are transporting to Mars, 1 millisecond of overlap between your present self and the person on Mars would mean that you didn't survive the process. Quick, kill me, otherwise I might die. The failure of so many theories has led some philosophers, like James Giles, to conclude that there are no persons. This theory has its merit. It echoes the thoughts of great thinkers like Buddha, and also maintains that the words that refer to persons are meaningful. Nevertheless, it's still a hard philosophical pill to swallow. David Lewis developed the time worm theory, which conceives of persons in a totally different way, as four-dimensional objects spread out over time. Although intuitive in many cases, Lewis has problems dealing with how to describe spin-off persons and Alzheimer's patients. In addition, his theory seems to suggest that, since a person would not exist until the time worm that it is complete, persons don't exist until they die. But this last consequence holds only if you adhere to a certain temporal ontology, a certain view of which moments in time exist and which ones don't. It is to that question that we shall turn next lecture.